welcome to Indian Americans Forum conference of GHFC elections, the real issues, the solutions, and the candidates' perspective. Now I would like to invite Dr. Lubna Sarwat. Lubna Sarwat, I would like to give a keynote address actually, apart from the candidates. I would like to get your perspective as a whole on the GHMC elections. And of course, what is the State Election Commission role and how the officials are functioning so far? And would you foresee a fair electoral process undergoing in GHMC election as an activist? So I would like you to take your own time. That's why I kept you at the last. Give us a perspective so that the people can understand. And I'm sure this program is going to go to the people who needs to be watching this, and particularly the election commissioner, as well as the police commissioner and other people. So please give us your comprehensive view about GHMC elections. Dr. Lubna Sarwat.
Yeah. Hello to Professor Jaimil Sajay Garu and Khalida Baji, and to all my remaining co-panelists. So I think this exercise of bringing the contestants from various wards of GHMC is a very fruitful exercise. Basically, to be very frank, except for Sheikh Pet, remaining all contestants came out very well with their issues. Now coming down to the basic point. When it comes to elections, the first and foremost thing is the electoral roll. The Election Commission of India itself has assured that no election will be conducted without a purified and authenticated. These are the ECI words. So the purified and authenticated electoral roll becomes the basis for the soul of democracy, which is electing, voting, casting vote or adult franchise. Now, if we look into that, right from 2014, after the Telangana government is formed, we expected that the government will take a de novo process. A de novo process means a fresh electoral roll, totally removing the previous roll. But that didn't happen. But after that, the 2016 GHMC elections were conducted. The 2016 GHMC elections were conducted without nota itself, which is totally unconstitutional. And I had reached the High Court also to declare this as an unconstitutional election. That didn't happen. Then we had the 2018 elections, which were the MLA elections. And everybody knew that more than 60 lakhs of votes were deleted. So many people, genuine voters, were not inside. And not genuine and fraudulent people were inside the electoral roll. There was further another chance in April 2019 when we had the MP elections. The same was the case. And now we have come down to GHMC 2020 elections, wherein we are having the ward-wise 150 wards elections. So if the latest scenario, as on even the midnight of yesterday when I was exercising and working on the Asif Nagar ward roll, I want to give a clear picture of what's in there in store for the citizen. Apart from indignity and apart from being treacherous with the citizen, and apart from showing its own incapacity and also it's doing so on a wanton, keeping everything as a mirage, keeping in darkness, what is happening with the GHMC right now is the Asif Nagar ward where I am contesting. As a case study, if we take, we have 51,000 voters according to the official list, out of which there are 61 polling booths in Asif Nagar ward. We have 61 polling booths in Asif Nagar ward. Out of the 61, I took two as a case study, polling booth number 1 and polling booth number 15. What we observed was, even a school student, when seeing the photo electoral roll, which goes like this, a photo electoral roll, what we see that even a school student can tell you that these two faces are identical. That means one person having two voter IDs, same faces, same address, same names. And let me just tell you that the figure that I put forward in 4 a.m. today, after working all through the night, is that in polling station number 1, where you have around 1,000 voters, we have around 20, let me give you the actual figure. We have around 23 duplicates and we have around 2 triplicates. So which means, and also in polling booth number 15, we have around 52 duplicates and we have around 2 quadruplicates. That is one person with identical faces and identical names and addresses, 4 voter IDs. So what is this showing us? I mean, what did we do with all the IT technology on the staff at our disposal? What sort of an indignation is this to the GHMC citizen who tolls and fills the coffers of the government? Are we going to run the elections on this? I have written to the State Election Commission today morning 4 a.m. that you will have to cancel the elections in Asif Nagar ward number 72 because it is the most vilest thing that can happen in the democracy, that you go to an election on a deceitful and unpurified electoral roll. So with this telling, giving you the actual figures of Asif Nagar ward, what I want to tell is that the entire GHMC ward list is like this, which means that if you'd say one tenth, now according to these 2 polling booths, 1/10 of the voter list is fraudulent. And this is a preliminary observational study, authentic study. Now, if you look into other things where people who have deleted, people who have shifted have not been deleted. People who are deceased or died have not been deleted. People who may have been disqualified are not deleted. And people who are genuine have not been included. Now, that will be the further detailed analytical study. But at Mawar level, which even a school student would have done if given this photo electoral roll, that study told us that 1/10 of the electoral rolls are improper, which means that another important thing that drives us to the conclusion that this electoral roll is a fraudulent one is that if there are 10,000 households approximately in Asif Nagar ward, how can the electoral roll be 50,000? Because one, if you take average as 4 people, that means every house has 4 to 5 voters. Are we telling that all the people in the household are voters? Then what about all the population that is below 18? Where is that counted? So this conclusively shows to us that the voter list is highly bloated, highly inflated, not authenticated and not purified. I hope the High Court of Telangana suomotoli takes cognizance of this and cancels the election of Asif Nagar ward 72. And it is open. Why I put it open is that other political parties will take the lead. And at least this can be a juncture where we can halt the elections and we can have a de novo process on every ward and have a purified electoral roll. And that will be the start and the basic foundation for a clean democracy. That is one thing I want to highlight, and that it should be in everybody's knowledge that I have brought this point. Now, coming to the very important point that I think you also had raised, it's about the ward committees. A very, very important mistake has happened, which somehow in this democracy has been left out unaccountable. When a corporator becomes a corporator, it is his first mandatory job as per the rule, as per the laid down constitutional rule, and as per the Municipal Act also, that he or she should be constituting a ward committee which contains a minimum of 15 members. Let me tell you, the past 5 years have not seen a single ward committee or a single ward committee meeting which is mandatory, because that is a forum given and handed down by the constitution, that in that forum the corporator and the people who elected the corporator sit at the same table, and then they decide, they put forth all the problems that are in their ward within a voter base of say 40,000, and then the committee will be highly representative. And that is a forum where the cooperative will actually tell you that this is what I have got the money from the government, these are your problems, we will raise the budget, I will put it to the council, the money has come, this is the expenditure, here is the balance, here are the open accounts. This is democracy, this is transparency, this is accountability. Was any citizen in GHMC given this respect and dignity is my question. No, none have answered yes in the entire Asif Nagar GHMC, and I know that has not been held across the GHMC. So who is accountable for this? It will comes from the Mount Ministry. Why isn't the Mount Ministry has ever asked in the past 5 years? And why is the State Election Commission not even asking about that to anybody? So if that is not a mandate of the, or it is not the ambit of the Election Commission, then we have to strengthen the Election Commission towards not just selling the candidates as corporators, but also to be making them hold and accountable and making the democratic process functional and not merely symbolic. The mandatory thing that was not done by the corporator is nowhere asked again, and the same corporator can again contest the election in spite of not having done a mandatory thing which is has to be done. So these are the new flaw. This is a major flaw. Now, first electoral process, then we saw that the major thing mandated by the constitution not being done by any corporator, and they are free to contest the elections again without any accountability. And believe me, the people don't even know that there should be a ward committee set up with the people's participation there. It is the government's duty, the election commission's duty, to educate the people and tell them their rights, where they don't even know that there is something existing like that. So given this background, I would want to highlight another very, very critical thing. That is the corruption, which many of our co-panelists also had highlighted. Corruption is reached at such a big heights that it should shatter any conscience-bearing person. Giving a very, very small example, because I have the full, whatever I speak on is fully backed by law, by constitution, by with proofs. What happened in Hyderabad in the year 2020 after the pandemic was the excess rains. The excess rains that came had to flow through a particular system, a structural system handed down to us by the ex-rulers, the Nizam governments, and that could not be maintained by the successive governments. So what happened was that the water that should have flown, it went into the residents, and some of the residents were actually inside the water bodies. So during this time, the Telangana government announced a flood relief in the most regressive manner, when they said that cash will be given to everybody and the local corporators, MLAs, would be there to distribute them. That was the most regressive manner, given that everybody were connected with the direct benefit transfer. So without exercising that and looking into the genuinity of the beneficiary, that scheme was run. And what happened across GHMC, the whole world saw that. The ladies were actually screaming that nothing has come to them and the properties have gone. And it was a shame for GHMC that when it rained, I flew away with the rain. When it rained, my property went away. When it rained, you know, my houses were lost. When it rained, I just got flooded in the city. I mean, it was a shame for us that we had to take the funds, and Delhi government, West Bengal government, Tamil Nadu government is giving us funds. Telangana, the richest, what for are we telling that we are the foremost and the unique in the world, when excess rain had us giving funds from other states? And we ourselves were telling to the government that we have so much of a disaster. And amidst this disaster, when Section 4, October 2020, the Telangana government themselves passed an act. And in that act, Section 4, it is clearly mentioned, which is actually an amendment to Section 24 of the GHMC Act. It is clearly mentioned that when you have a natural disaster or an even incoming pandemic, then you will not be going to the elections. So it was questioned to the government. We raised this point that how did you declare the elections when people were queuing before the MeSeva for the relief funds? So this is such an anarchic situation in which you don't have an electoral roll properly. You have the corruption at such heighted things that before the MeSeva program was announced, the cash doling that was going on in my own Asif Nagar ward, which is a dry area when compared to the given conditions of giving the flood relief, because none of the houses were flooded here with water. So in this dry area also, the MIM, the municipal corporation officials, the photos have come down to me where they're actually giving the funds. And the double corruption that happened was, one, you didn't give it in the wet area or the flooded area, you gave it in the dry area. And the second jolt of corruption over there was that The poor people were gathered, the photos were taken, the signatures were taken, their Aadhaar cards, telling that each one is given 10,000 and those people were given 1 or 2,000 each. This is the height of corruption that we are facing here with no accountability at all. Is that the way at all that you give a relief fund without assessing and without documenting what is actually their loss? Property, life, houses, what is the loss? What is the documentation that is done? So is this how we use the money? I mean, this is whose money is this? It is the people's money, the taxpayers' money. So this is the basis on which the elections are declared. And suddenly, even when all this problem is not resolved, and their own act tells that a disaster and a pandemic cannot entail an election, in these anarchic situations, lo and behold, an election has been declared with a minimum, bare minimum time for everybody. And another point is that we have been raising. When big parties such as the BJP, the Congress, the TDP, and many other recognized parties, and even TRS and the MIM, all these parties are handed over free electoral rolls. Whereas the point to be noted here is that all these parties are drawing funds through electoral bonds. Electoral bonds are something that the Election Commission of India itself is contending in the Supreme Court, and the case is lying there. But still, all these big parties, unaccountable money is flowing into their coffers. We do not know which hawala money it is. We do not know which corporate is doing it. Nobody knows about it. And these monies are flowing into them, and they are being given a free electoral roll, their candidates. But when these independent candidates, they are going to the electoral roll, they have been asked to shell down money, whether it is for a corporate election or an MLA or an MP, you always have to shell down. I yesterday shelled down around 3,600, and for an MLA, you have to shell down around 21,000 to get a roll. And for an MP election, because the constituency is wider, the voter list is wider, you have to shell down double or triple that amount. So the question is these things which basically they don't answer this, that why is a party which is allowed even the unaccounted money with full in coffers, overflowing coffers, given a free roll, and why an independent candidate should pay for it? And another important point is that what I face the situation, every expenditure the election court, GHMC election observer told, has to be digital. If the only 20,000 out of the 5 lakhs limit is going to be allowed in cash, all the 4,80,000 has to be in digital. Wow. Then 3,600, I appealed to them, I will pay it digitally. They said, no, you have to pay it in cash. So this is how unprepared and anarchic situation and unprepared situation, but the elections have to happen. Because something has to happen, and something somewhere the people have to be, some people have to be there. No, it is not free and fair poll. It is about democracy. Let us not keep telling that hum jeetenge ya memu galistam. It is about who the people will choose will win. Let the parties have the guts to tell that. Why aren't they afraid? Why are they afraid of? Why when I went to the Asif Nagar, my own ward where I'm contesting, why did the MIM people have to tell me that ye hamara area hai? What is this hamara area? Is it not challenging the election process? The election commission which told me, you are contesting and they have given me a ticket and they're telling me that you contest here? Isn't it challenging the parliamentary process of the constitution itself when a particular party is hindering the other candidates from coming in, canvassing and campaigning over there? So whom are they challenging actually? So this is the processes that we people, and the reason for my own contesting itself is to root out such demarcations where people want to have a stronghold which is not theirs. Once the election are declared, it is open to everybody. Any party can go there anytime. Even when there is an MIM corporator winning here, then also any party can go there. So in these situations, it is not welcome and it is highly, highly reprehensible. The most reprehensible another thing was that it's not just about telling that you cannot come here. It is about warning the female woman candidate in a woman reserved constituency when all the male people, MIM people are telling that if you come here again, aapki khair nahi rahengi. This is the height of election campaigning, the process that is going on here. So there has to be some accountability, there has to be some answer, there has to be some rules in place that if this happens, this is going to happen, if this happens, this is going to happen. There's nothing of that sort here, you know. and it will there will not be any time bound given to you that yes, your complaint has been registered and within this day this is going to happen. You don't have such things. What are people afraid of? If we don't have this time bound frame and this milestones and everything, you cannot give justice. You know, justice delayed is justice denied. You will have to give. It is a democracy. You will have to lay down the rules. The rules will have to discuss. But nothing of that sort has been happening here. Now, this is about corruption. Now, coming down to the ground situation, many of my co-panelists, contestants, had raised important issues on education, on hospitals and other things. Coming to the Mohalla Clinic and other points, you know. See, Mohalla Clinic and these Basti Dawakhanas, these are not the points. For every lakh and 2 lakh population, you of course need to have a government hospital there with Ayush facilities. What are these Basti Dawakhanas and Mohalla clinics? Let me tell you, even during my MP election time in 2014 and 2018 of Karwan, let me tell you that they were all reports. The whole world knew, it was there on everywhere, that the government hospitals of Falaknuman and elsewhere, only a nurse was sitting there. And anybody who comes there was being handed over paracetamol. This was in the knowledge of the government itself. So this is the, halak, this is the condition of the government hospitals. And without rectifying the government hospital situation, and in the own Karwan where I went, the Golconda area hospital is so worse. And people from Ibrahim Nagar, Ibrahim Cheruvu area, Vasavi Engineering College area, which comes under the Karwan constituency, they would travel all these kilometers to the Golconda area hospital because there's no government hospital near them and they fall under Karwan. This being the situation that you don't have a proper demarcation that every ward should have a government hospital, you're telling us that you're giving us Basti Dawakhanas and Mohalla clinics, which one of the contestants actually told us now that there's nobody sitting in there. Who wanted those clinics? We already have the primary health centers. We needed an upgradation of these two hospitals with proper scannings and with upgraded standard technology and with proper staff. The whole government is known that Osmania General Hospital is not staffed properly. Gandhi Hospital is not staffed properly. Every area hospital is crying for the nurses, crying for the hospitals. And you are telling us that you're giving us Mohalla clinics and the Basti Dawakhanas. Man, give us a break. What are you telling us, bhai? Why make so itna indignity? Why so much of indignity to us? Just because you don't have ward committees there to tell for people to open up their mouths and tell you that these are the problems that we are facing. Now, another important problem that every street, every contestant also has told about, I want to just highlight that. That is the sewage problem. Every road has the, and in Asif Nagar, where exactly I went there, where this actually stopping me, hindering me happened, every woman was telling that, please look at our streets and look at the square manholes of the GHMC, which are called as storm water pipes. By God, they are the most unscientific and most non-commonsensical thing to happen, because the GHMC is telling the rain to fall into that manhole. Do we dictate the rain to fall into that manhole, which are just so unengineeringly designed that the rain doesn't, the contours doesn't allow the rain to go into that? Who, which engineer and who is doing that? And the manhole is always half inside and half outside. Please come to the street where I have surveyed and please come and see and highlight that. Is this the storm water that's going to carry? And another most vile thing that is happening. Every of these stormwater pipes is carrying the sewage of the locality. By God, 90% of the sewage of these stormwater pipes that the Maud minister was telling that he will expand more, they all carry the sewage water of the locality. These I have already highlighted to the government, to the HMWSSB, to the GHMC. By God, this is all that you have to rectify. What are the people asking? Why they are not asking your Pragati Bhavans? They are not asking the Shastripuram OYC Hills bungalows. They are just asking for basic things. They are just asking, give us our proper government school. Give us our proper government college. And let me tell you, the entire, I don't call our old city, I called it the original Shahi city. Hamari jo original city hai, usme for the past many years, we don't even see, at least in the past 6 years, and Telangana government came and we had a lot of hopes. Not a single government junior degree college has been opened. In fact, existing schools have been closed. I, through my manifesto, have promised that this ward will have a government junior degree college. Why? Because that is the necessity. Where will the girls go? Parents are not allowing given the situations. When will they be educated? How will they be educated? Who is going to address all these problems? And what about the government hospital? Every ward should have a government hospital. Who wants these Bastinda Vakanas where even the government hospitals presently are unstaffed? So this being the situations, and the most important is about the water. WHO, World Health Organization, and the Union government have told clearly that 140 liters per person per day is the mandatory minimum that every person should receive for a standard, decent, hygienic life. I am asking these corporators, these MLAs, these MPs, and this MOD minister and this chief minister, are you telling us that you have given us this? In a single GHMC area, in a single ward, you have a huge disparity that a person may get just 10 liters because they catch the water at the public tap, and then they store, they don't even have a proper storage facility. जाके देखिए भाई उनके घरों में, ये पीछे जो घर है उसमें, हमारे घरों में एक घर में दो बाथरूम है, वहां पर तीन घरों के लिए एक बाथरूम है, तीन घर यानी 3 × 5 18 या 20 आदमी डालिए, 20 आदमी के लिए एक बाथरूम, भाई सोचिए आप, डॉर्मेटरी जैसा है या तीन घरों के जैसा है वो, who will address these problems? And what about the asbestos sheet housing? Who will address this? Why these people are living this asbestos and these houses that are having 3 houses, 1 bathroom? What about the government lands? What about the work lands? Why they are not being used for the community? Why they are not being used for the ward people? Are they not meant for these purposes? And the government auctions the government lands. In 2017, when the government was auctioning the government lands, I went to the High Court because I felt like our lands are going away because the precious government lands, government offices and minority schools and many offices and hostels are in the private buildings. Are these government lands not meant to construct the government hostels and social welfare hostels? Is it not for the government offices? Government lands have been sold out to private parties, where now the Lulu is coming out with the biggest mall in the Asia. What land was that in Khanamet? It is government land that was sold away in auction for acres. And what did the government do with that money is the biggest question. They should be able to show us, we sold this government land, this is the money we got, and these are the welfare projects we executed. What else did we ask for? CM relief fund. You got all the funds during the pandemic. You got all the funds during the flood into the CM relief fund. What did we ask for? We simply told, tell us from where you got the funds. Tell us where the funds are being utilized. What else did we ask? Is this not mandatory for them? Is this transparent not mandatory? Even this is not being given. This is the high level of unaccountability, not even any transparency, no people's participation. This is the situation overall in the GHMC and overall in the Telangana, which needs to be very, very quickly rectified. And these are the botherations that made me actually once again enter into the electoral fray and make the people, give them a respectful life, first to giving them more and more and more of information, because they should know their rights. They should know their rights to ask, to question. But those very rights are being denied through low systems of education, through low systems of education, health, and through low systems of public transport. So these are the things that we need to address, and these are the things that we need to discuss. And ward committee was that very platform, and ward committee, that is why it was not executed by any of the corporators, because therein you will actually have to be very transparent, and you'll have to face the public and on the same platform, and you'll have to give them your paison ki safai. That is why the ward committee is not being done. And my coming into the fray is also questioned by many people, and I want to answer it here because it's an educative question actually. When people critically ask me that you weren't MP in 2014, you were contesting for MLA for 2018, and then now you're here again in 2020 GHMC elections. What is this? What are you? Why are you contesting so many times? But at the same people, two answers to them, one in defense and one telling them actually what it is that they should be asking rather. See, what I'm telling is that the election, do you demean the position of a corporator? Are you telling me that a corporator's position is a low one and MP position is the higher one? Are you telling me this? corporator position is the one mandated by the Constitution 74-7 amendment itself. That is the respectful position of that. It has a great onus with a great connectivity with the grassroots people. And it has a special body from the Telangana state that conducts it. Do not demean the position for God's sake. And I never feel demeaned or small. I am very happy that it's a small area where I could go more into the people and more talk to them. This is the celebration of democracy when you're contesting in an election. By God, please understand in those angles. For all my critics, this is an answer. And another point that I want them to think over is, you ask a candidate who is not hesitating to contest on various levels, but you do not question a candidate who is repeatedly contesting for an MP for the past so many times. You are not questioning a candidate who is contesting repeatedly for MLA for the same position. You are not questioning a candidate who is contesting corporator for the same position from so many elections. Means one election, 4 years, means maybe five times, six times. He's a six-time MLA, he's a fifth-time MP, he's that. By God, why are you not questioning them? So I want the people to think more critically, to think more out of the box, to think more in terms of how more transparent and how more functional can the democracy be. Just to give more information, don't be afraid to give citizen information. Be bold enough to give them the information, allow them to question you, and be ethical enough that you are able to answer them, and be more ethical to give them the answers even before they ask. This is exactly what I am promising my Asif Nagar ward. I am telling them that there will be zero corruption, there will be zero pollution, and there will be zero muzzle power, there will be zero power fear. There will be zero encroachments. And I'm telling them that you will have every street and every lane garbage free and sewage water free. I'm telling you, this is not rocket science. This is not difficult to do. It requires just a little of ethics into what you're doing, and everything will set right, because there is money, but the money is not realizing on the ground in well-being and welfare of the people. And that is why we came up with a very proper vision for the Asif Nagar. The vision entails that right from the education, right from the health, every point we have covered in our vision, we have given with dates. I promised my Asif Nagar that on 4th December, if the Asif Nagar is choosing candidate number 8, I do not even highlight my name. It should be candidate number 8. I told my Asif Nagar people, if candidate number 8 is winning, it is Asif Nagar, every citizen, who is winning. Because the candidate number 8 doesn't get anything. But the Asif Nagar constituency will get tarakki, will get development. Will get development means what? I have given even that in my manifesto here. I told them that development doesn't mean that you have a mall connected or you have a overbridge immediately coming like the cable bridge over the Durgam Kherbu. It is not that. Development means being able to increase the purchasing power of the citizen of Asif Nagar. Being able to create that the Asif Nagar citizen is able to increase in his wealth and able to come up properly with proper education, health, and other public infrastructure. And I am telling you, the last one is about the PDS. The PDS system is so bad that the domestic worker and her husband, of course, who is actually being a boozer, as most of the husbands are here in the lower strata, of course, encouraged by the Telangana government. So these domestic workers, they are not getting dal even from the PDS. Who should give them dal? So in our manifesto, in our vision, we said that if after elections on December 4, if candidate number 8 is the corporator by the voters' vote, then, and if the voter list is pure and authenticated, and if the process itself is very fair without any muzzle power, then by December 20, the ward committee will be constituted. We have given the dates in our manifesto that by December 20, the ward committee with 50% men and women will be constituted with all the representation from senior citizens, youth, and business persons and students, etc. Then we said that supply of 140 liters will be definitely be ensured and adequate. When I went to houses, I found that storage facility is not adequate. So definitely the storage facility will be looked into and provided for them. And then we said that the own housing is very important, because here there's a very cramped housing, and we will definitely be ensuring that every person, a court panelist also has highlighted that rightfully, that the people who don't have an own land or an own house should definitely be given top priority in the housing, and that can be done very well at a ward level. Then we also told that for every government school or college, and whoever student is going from the Asif Nagar ward to a government school or college, whether the college is in the Asif Nagar ward or not, they will be given supplied milk and badam to their families also, because the government, I have been repeatedly telling that the government should make it mandatory to give the immunity boosting food to the people. I appeal to the government to supply masks and badam and milk through the PDS. How will they develop their immunity? How will they, which percentage of the Asif Nagar ward is drinking milk? By God, no child is drinking milk. I feel guilty, because when I drink milk, I feel guilty about it. So these are the things that we have actually put down in written. And we have also mooted a vision that laptop should be given to every first year degree student in the government college. By that, what happens is these children will be actually motivated to join degree first year. Degree first year, man ko laptop mil jayega, so they will definitely join the degree. And we will take an undertaking that they will definitely complete the degree. That will drastically enhance the higher education percentage of the Asif Nagar ward. That is our one of our vision for this. And recently, I was so happy that Scotland declared that all its women will be given free menstrual pads. I was so happy with the declaration. And that declaration was already made in our manifesto, that these all the women will be given cotton and eco-friendly menstrual pads to all the girls and women of the Asif Nagar ward, and as a respect to the motherhood and as a respect to the women. And the very important thing that we stated is we are going to pull up a database of all the youth who want to pursue higher education, and of all the youth who want to be employed, given taking their present education, taking their present skills, so that we can work on them towards what can be done further. And then lastly, we said that no garbage, no sewage on any street of Asif Nagar. So what we were just telling is that we want to bring in an educated, a speaking, a courageous and passionate corporator. We only appeal to the Asif Nagar voters that please give a chance. You have given a chance to many people. So you try giving a chance to candidate number 8, because if candidate number 8 wins, it is about the entire Asif Nagar winning, entire Asif Nagar citizens winning. So another major concern in Asif Nagar ward is about the asbestos sheet houses. Asbestos is not good according to the World Health Organization also, and according to many scientists. So we want to undo the asbestos roofing in the Asif Nagar ward, and we want to make them sun approachable and hygienical. Then also definitely we want to have a junior and degree college right in the Asif Nagar ward, so that every girl is encouraged and every boy is encouraged. When there's a nearby governmental high infrastructure educational institution, there is so much of child labor in Asif Nagar ward, even that will be removed, and the children will be attracted towards a highly infrastructured government free education where they're having so many facilities such as a protein food and other things. Then we are very concerned about the playground in Asif Nagar ward. Children play in every street and people actually shoo them away. Bechare bachche kahan jaake khelenge? But their playing also is wrong, because we also face it that the ball comes and hits our windows and people in the houses. So playground is very important for the health and the immunity boosting of every child. Also, we have mooted a special women's park for the Asif Nagar ward, because women don't go out. Women can come to the, if it is a women's park, they will be motivated to go there. It will be a big social gathering of all the communities, and only women, and they can be free in the greenery and in the sun. So that is one thing that we are very passionate about. And also we want to upgrade the present primary healthcare center or have a new government hospital with Ayush facility, so that everything will come under there, with Unani, with yoga, with homeopathy, with Siddha and everything. And our promise is that Asif Nagar should turn into a 100% literacy ward. And also there is a sizable old age population in Asif Nagar. In fact, the voters themselves above 60-70 are about more than 5,000 voters. And of course, I am not guaranteeing the genuinity of that, because as we saw what happened. And we are going to have a senior citizen representative in our ward committee. And we are going to work with all the communities and people towards removing and eradication of jehaz and dowry. And we are going to enable all these foods through the PDS, and enable, of course, immunity boosting health. I have already told that. So now, apart from the ward committee, we have a very important plan where we are going to have teams. because only 15 people will be mandatory in the ward committee. So we will have, and this will have representatives from all the sectors, business, women, senior citizens, everything. But we will have teams. The teams will be sports team, it will be jobless team, it will be skill development, it will be anti-corruption team, because we have promised that there will be no corruption here. And it will be peace committees team, it will be anti-liquor and drugs teams, because we want to remove the drug and the liquor menace which is troubling the Asif Nagar ward a lot. And we will have environment improvement teams, because there are many people who are passionate about environment. And we will have Anganwadi and health teams. And this is the type of one important team will be the Esman Sagar Protection and Himayat Sagar Protection Team. Why? Because this Asif Nagar ward and this original city receives the sweet waters of Gandipet, and we have nearby the Asif Nagar filter beds also. And just before filing my nomination on 18th of November, with the top officials of the water board, I had surveyed the Gandipet Usman Sagar, and I was shocked and depressed and tearful when I saw that the government of Telangana is constructing iron, tall, strong fencings and compound walls right inside the drinking water reservoir of the people of original city and the entire GHMC. What more deceit can the people have? And we actually saw the encroachments like the Oro sports, which the officers in front of me admitted this is actually in the FTL of a drinking water designated reservoir. What more shabby things can we expect from the government? How much more will they shock our consciences? But we want the judiciary to be shocked. We want the officials to be shocked. But it is we who are getting more and more shocked. So a team in Asif Nagar ward will actually handle this. And actually, before filing my nomination, I gave a notice even to the High Court telling that Satyagraha will be the only recourse that we will be taking if none of them responds and do not remove the government constructed wall inside the reservoir and all the encroachments such as Oro sports from inside the reservoir. And we will have our way, because we are on the path of the truth and we are on the path of what the people actually need. Now that will be an important team. And of course, we will have special teams for the welfare of the important professions that are there in the Asif Nagar. This is the last point. We will have, because Asif Nagar ward has a lot of carpenters, it has a lot of dairy farms, it has a lot of tailoring also. So these sort of professions will have separate team. Why? I will tell you, it requires a special team, because there's a lot of waste that comes out of it. I was very happy when one of the co-panelists and a contestant raised about composting. She was very, very right. I will meet her if possible later. The point is, the carpenters, the waste that comes out of the carpenter, when they throw it away somewhere in the open, the other women who stay in some of the slums, they come there and they pick up something which is useful for their firewood. So look at this, something that is a waste for somebody is actually a resource for somebody. So for that, what is to be done is the inventory of the waste being generated has to be documented. And this has to be now networked into who actually required it, whether outside the ward or inside the ward. So this can be very easily done. It is a small area. Every ward is demarcated. It can be even actually sub wards also can be done. And this can be streamlined and a very harmonious and a very peaceful and a very energetic, a very participative. And every person who feels that they are secure, that no muscle power will be there on them, that they feel a dignity that yes, we will be asked for by the corporator. This is our vision for Asif Nagar, and I wish this for every other ward in GHMC also. Thank you for the time given, Professor. And
thank you. That was a comprehensive overview of coming up GHMC election, the role of the State Election Commission, the electoral rolls.